Hello everybody, welcome to Crafty Soup. My name is Misty. I have a Feature Friday video for you today all about watercolors. My Feature Friday series happens once a month where I feature some sort of product or technique and show you at least 10 ways to use it. And because we're using watercolor today, I do have watercolor paper. Now some of these techniques can work on cardstock or mixed media paper, and I'll try and let you know when and where that is true. But for the most part, you're going to want watercolor paper. I've cut my paper down to 3x4 cards because I can easily add that to a project, a card, or a scrapbook page. I have a spray bottle and my watercolor palette, and then we'll talk about how you don't have to have this level of watercolor. I've got various size brushes. We'll use that big one at the very end if you're curious. And then I've got a towel for cleanup as well as two pots of water, one for rinsing my brush and one for clean water for using for techniques. So let's go ahead and get started with the first way. So for this first technique, you are going to need a piece of scratch plastic. It could be thin or thick. Some people like thicker better, but that's up to you. Now, when we're talking about watercoloring, there's so many water-based mediums like reinkers, markers, spritzes, even ink pads, and you can use all of those to watercolor with. If you press them onto something like plastic, you can create yourself a palette. So here I've pressed it onto plastic, added a spritz of water. That's an important step to this technique. And then I just smush it on my paper. And as you can see, you can get some really fun color mixes going on. I just used the two colors on that, and there's a lot of color variation. What's fun about that technique is that it's out of your control. So you can get some really great patches and blends of color, but it could also go wrong. So just keep that in mind if you're trying that technique. Moving on to number two, we're going to talk about washes. This is kind of what people think about when they think about watercolor, is just this swatch of color that goes across a project. Now I'm doing a wash across the entire surface of my quote-unquote canvas, but you could also do washes in smaller patches and areas of your paper. It doesn't have to completely cover everything, and really it is just painting on that wet paint onto your canvas. If you're painting with your paint nice and wet, you can always get some interesting color blends going on. Now, I didn't get too many, but you can see a little orange in there where I mixed my pink and yellow. Next up, we have stripes. If you're a little intimidated by watercoloring, this could be an easy way to kind of get started. And you can add just little bits of color using stripes in any colors you want. I'm kind of going rainbow here. And you could add these behind a photo as a photo mat. You could add them to the edge of a project just for a little pop of color in addition to all of whatever pattern papers and things you may be using. And this one would work okay on cardstock as long as your paint isn't too wet. And I should say that the ink smushing technique can work on cardstock too. Again, as long as you're not diluting it down with too much water. The washes are gonna be best on a mixed media paper and even really best on a watercolor paper. So I hope I caught us up with some of those tips as we go. One other thing I want to say about stripes is you'll get different shapes of stripes depending on how you hold your brush. The stripes on the left, I was kind of pressing the bristles of my brush down into the paper, and you can see it kind of ends up with a rounded edge. The stripes on the right, I am starting with the tip of my brush kind of upright and touching the paper, and that gives me a straighter line. You can overlap your stripes, which will lead to color mixing if your paints are still wet, or you can keep your stripes separated by gaps if you want them to stay true to color. So you have lots of options here, including this option where I am doing stripes of various shades of green. So I'm picking up green, adding in a little blue, adding in a little yellow, and I'm adding stripes randomly around the page, and then I'm overlapping stripes. Now some of my paint will have started to dry a little bit, which will interact differently with the new wet paint. Some of my paint on the paper is still wet, and when I add more wet paint on top of that, I'll get much more blending going on. So this technique, again, is a little bit out of your control, and you can play with it and see what kind of fun variations you can get. And here is a bit of a close-up look at those stripes. You can see rounded stripes, straight stripes, and then my very artsy stripes. Next up, we have borders, which is certainly related to stripes, and I'm just going to use one color here, but I'm going to show you different strokes. Now, when you just stroke your paint, your paint will fade away as you use up that water and paint on your brush, and you can leave it that way, or you can go back and paint over the same stripe again to get a more solid, firm color. And then here you see I'm using just the tip of my brush to paint another stroke, and I can get different levels of borders. And this one does take a more steady hand, and as you can see, my borders are a bit wobbly, but that's the homemade feel of watercolor. If I wanted something perfect, I would get it machine made. And before we move away from borders, this could work on regular cardstock. However, if you have that fade away happening with your paint and you're trying to make it a smoother, solid color, you might not have as much luck on cardstock. So experiment and try and see what you've got going on. So let's move on to ink pads. Now, I did mention before that ink pads can be used squished onto a piece of plastic and that you can create your own paint palette that way, but they can also be used directly on watercolor paper. So I like using ink cubes for this because I have more size control. If you have a bigger canvas, you certainly could use a bigger ink pad. And here I showed you that you could just put the square down, but if you rotate your cubes or your pads, you can get a circle. And when you add water, it starts flowing that watercolor, and then you get that soft effect that watercolor has to it. Now you can also, here's kind of a bonus technique, if you add enough water and kind of give it a couple of strokes for the water to flow around, you can also get drips with this. And so you could certainly put watercolor at the edge of a page without ink pads and do this dripping technique on its own. But I think this style of a controlled space along with drips is very dynamic and interesting. And as you can see in the photo, wherever your wet paint is touching, you will get a little bit of color bleeding. So keep that in mind when you're creating your spots of color. Now I'm going to move on to what I like to call the coloring book method. There are some products on the market that are intended for various coloring techniques that will include watercoloring. If you want to do it at home and you have some stamps around that are outline stamps, use a waterproof ink. And I prefer the VersaFine ink. And then go ahead and stamp on your paper. This could be on cardstock or it could be on watercolor paper. It really depends on how much water you add. Because watercolor paper has a lot of texture to it, you can see that top image there I stamped and it wasn't super crisp. And if you have a stamp positioning tool, that can help you on watercolor paper. It just depends on the look you're going for. I don't mind sometimes if my images aren't super crisp. And then I'm just going to start adding color. That top bit, I just washed plain water across, and then I'm just tapping in color. And that color is just going to bleed and flow into the water and do its own thing. If you want more control, you can add your paint to sections of the image. And here's just a quick tip. If you add a darker color of that paint to where any parts of the image meet up together, that'll add some natural shadow to your image to give it a little more depth. Now, figuring out shadowing for painting is definitely a lot of practice skill, but that one tip is a quick tip to get better results. Now you can see I did go ahead and paint up both of those images, and I went for a similar color palette with the actual succulents, but then I gave a wash of color around the edge of my image, and that can create a more dynamic piece. And I went bold with one, and I went subtle with one, so don't be afraid to mix it up. We are going to keep working with stamps, and we're going to explore a little bit of difference between photopolymer stamps versus rubber stamps and outline stamps versus solid image stamps. So I'm going to create a selection here of one flower and one leaf pattern. And I did just kind of wash off my stamp there to make sure it was clean. And here I'm just kind of stamping a random bit of flowers onto this. This is watercolor paper. This technique's really going to work best on watercolor paper. And then I'm tapping water onto that image, and you can see that it starts to bleed and flow. And with an outline image, it's up to you how much water you want to add. If you add a lot of water, you're going to lose a lot of the structure of the image and get more of a blurry look to it. And if you use less water, you're going to keep more of a solid outline with just a hint of foggy color. With solid images, you can get more of that kind of effect that we got with the ink pads, where you stamp your solid image down on your paper and then you tap water onto the image and it starts to move and shift that paint. And here it's a little hard to see, but the image there on the right is watercolored and the rest of them have not been watercolored yet. So we're going to do another technique using these. Now I am doing multi-generational stamping here, which means I only ink my stamp one time. I stamp it and then I go ahead and stamp it again for the second generation and even sometimes the third or fourth generation. And this is where photopolymer versus rubber stamps come into play, because the photopolymer don't hold as much ink as the rubber does. So you won't get good second gen stamping. But you can also ink up your stamp, stamp it off on a scratch piece of paper, and then stamp it on your project, and that will force a second gen stamping so that you get different layers. And why I'm doing that here is that I'm creating a bouquet, and I want some of those flowers to be in the foreground and some of those flowers to be in the background. And then when I add water to this, it's gonna force that perspective even more. And then I'm gonna go ahead and create greenery around my bouquet with the solid leaf stamp. Now I do wanna cover up the flowers so that these leaves don't overlap. And here you can see I've got 3, 4, 5, almost 6 generations of stamping with that rubber stamp. So that is one of the benefits of rubber. And then I am going to go ahead and drop water onto those leaves. Sometimes I'm adding more water to get more blurring, and sometimes less water to keep the image crisper. And then I decided I wanted a bit more definition to the actual flowers, and so I will dry my project and then add more stamping on top of that and continue with my painting until I have the bouquet effect that I'm looking for. So there's a look at both of those stamping uses. You can get more of a patterned paper look with the piece on the right, or you can get more of an artistic painting look with the piece on the left. Using stencils can be a really fun and easy way to add watercoloring. My biggest tip here is don't add too much water to your paint, because it will bleed under the stencils. So keep your paint fairly dry. Now I'm going to tape down my watercolor paper to my table so it doesn't shift, and then I'm going to tape down my stencil to my table on top of that. And then I'm going to create dry paint, and then I'm just going to squiggle my brush into the stencil. Now I have a very small stencil with tiny spaces, so I will have to wiggle it in there a little bit. And again, if you have too much water, that's going to soak up. And that will actually come up in just a moment. And then I am just switching colors up as I go without washing my brush off too much, and that's going to help my colors naturally blend. I can also purposefully go back and add a second color to paint that's already there to purposefully blend it. And then I start painting my blue, and then that is where I got too much water. So I quickly grab my towel and soak that up so that it doesn't have time to bleed, and I dry off my paintbrush a little bit, and then I can keep working. Let's go ahead and reveal that piece. And this is so fun and so pretty. I hope you guys enjoy this stencil technique. In order to clean up your stencil, just give it a spritz with your spray bottle or wipe it down with a wet rag, and that makes cleanup super easy. You're done. And because that technique is a very dry paint technique, you can do that on your regular cardstock as well as watercolor paper. So far, we've talked about adding images using stamps and stencils, but you can also paint your own images. If you can draw hearts and stars with a pencil, you can draw hearts and stars with a paintbrush. So here I am using a fairly dry paint technique to just draw stars on. Because this paint is technically still wet, I can touch in a couple of extra colors onto my previous color and get a little bit of blending. And the success of that is really just going to depend on how wet or dry your paint is and how fast it's drying on your paper. You can do this on any paper. Cardstock will certainly soak up and dry a little bit faster and prevent some of that blending. So experiment, 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 and see what you can try. Now I was using a flat paintbrush for this, which will give me kind of spread out images. You can certainly use a more pointy paintbrush for this and get sharper, crisper images. Depends on what you want to do. I'm going to set that aside to dry, and we're going to paint some hearts. So here you can see I am just painting in a solid heart shape with my pink paint. And I'm using a little bit more water for this one. So if you're doing it this way, you're going to need watercolor paper. And because all of this paint is wet, the water is going to help flow the colors partially together. And however much of that secondary color you add will kind of determine how much it mixes and blends. So here I'm showing you, I did blue down on my paper first, and then I'm going to add the pink in on top of that. And you can see, depending on which color you start with, your color blending is actually gonna look kind of different. So here is a bonus way to add paint to your projects is just spatters. If you like the kind of speckled spatter look, you don't need fancy sprays. You can just use any of these watercolor mediums to add that. It could certainly be a standalone element that you add to your projects, or you can mix and match various techniques that we've been talking about. We are in the home stretch now, so let's go ahead and talk about backgrounds. And for this, I am going to switch up my canvas size. So I've got a 12 by 12 sheet of watercolor paper, and I am going to use my jumbo brush. Now, you can do this without the jumbo brush. You don't have to have this special tool. But I do have the special tool, and I bought it just so I could do this technique. So I'm going to go ahead and use it today. So because this brush is so big, you're going to have to make sure you have plenty of paint and water going on. So I am going to create myself a big paint palette. And then I'm just going to use this brush in a swirly circular motion. And I am going to create a background here, kind of that grid style with circles and not squares. And I'm going to create a fun background that will become the base of a scrapbook layout for the future. So if you're using a smaller size brush and you don't feel confident that you can get a nice circle, you can trace a circle like a die or a cup, something along those lines, and paint inside, I should say trace it with pencil, and paint inside the pencil line. Try not to touch that pencil line because the watercolor paint can trap the pencil and you want to be able to erase that pencil line later. So you can get this look without having this big paintbrush. So here is the final piece. All of those circles I'm going to use to add a couple of circles will get small photos, one circle will get some journal lines, and then the other circles will get bits of embellishment. And this is a fun background to start a grid style layout. I do want to make one note here. This blue circle has these kind of lightning stroke lines coming out of part of it, and that is called a bloom or a cauliflower or a backflow. You might hear various names for this. And that's because that part of the paper had more water than the surrounding edges did, and that water pushes the pigment around. For this technique, I'm perfectly happy for that to happen, because this is a very artful, random technique. If you wanted very smooth images, you're gonna wanna control your water a lot more. We're not done with backgrounds yet. I am gonna use that jumbo brush to do a jumbo wash background. And remember, last time I showed you a wash, I covered the entire canvas. Here, I am just doing the wash in sections, and I am trying to blend my wash a little bit. And here you can see me adding spatters to this project, and wherever those spatters hit the wet wash, they're going to enlarge and bleed out more, and wherever they hit the dry paper, they're going to be more crisp spatters. So you can get different types of fun spatters depending on how you approach your spatters. So what happens if you have a piece that you just don't like? And this was actually a piece where I was demonstrating and practicing stuff on, and so I was never going to keep this piece for anything anyway. Use punches, use dyes, don't throw that piece away. It can be turned into other elements and used on your projects in fun ways. So you can certainly add watercolor to projects this way and not feel like you have to have any of these watercolor skills mastered, because the fun thing about punches and dyes is that you can position them over your favorite part of the watercolor project and just save that portion of the watercoloring. So that's it. I've given you more than 10 ways to add watercoloring to your projects. If you have a favorite of these techniques, you can leave me comments below. I'd love to read what you enjoy. Do you have watercoloring experience and I missed something and there's something you would like to share with all of us? Leave those comments below too. And for that pesky YouTube algorithm, if you could give my video a like, I'd really appreciate it because it does help my channel. I will be back next week with some process videos and possibly one other fun project. I hope you'll come back and join me then.